Good afternoon, everyone. That was mad weak. Good afternoon, everyone. All right, I know we're all tired, a little wore out, so I won't take much of your time and set my timer on here so I can move expeditiously. Have you been having a good Sabbath?
Amen.
I've been having a blessed Sabbath. The Lord has been watering my soul and all this week. And so I just want to share with you my little segment for today. It's called Dressing for the Party. And I'll tell you in a little moment where we're going, and then we'll go there, and hopefully the Holy Ghost, well, we don't hope. We have faith that the Holy Ghost will bless us all and get us ready for our next message. Amen?
Amen.
I'm going to ask you to bow your heads with me as we seek the Lord in prayer. Dear kind Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this time. I just thank you for everything you've been doing for me all week, Lord. I just want to personally just say, Lord, you're a good God. You're merciful. Your mercy endureth forever. And I know, Lord, that you want us to go to the next level, wherever that is for each one of us in our relationship with you. And you've designed this weekend, and you've designed today to take us there so that we can not just enjoy what we hear, but that so we can go home, open our Bibles, fall on our knees, and say, Lord, what would you have me do? And so I pray that for, I want to speak that into the lives of each one in front of me. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Now, while I'm speaking, I hope you guys pray for me because I'm a little excited. I don't get to speak at Southgate much, so I want to talk to you guys all afternoon. But there's another speaker, and so I got to move expeditiously because you don't know, this is my home church. I'm gone, and the Lord has to take me here and there, but this is my home church, and I prayed for this church. No, you don't understand. When I didn't have a home church, I didn't have a church to go to, I wasn't a member of any church, when you guys were having church here and Pastor Hill was here, I was on my knees in the South area praying for a church. And God led me and gave me this church. And so I'm just so thankful for you all. I'm thankful for what the Holy Spirit's going to do. And we're going to get into our topic, dressing for the party. And we're going to talk about dress, maybe not so much today. I got one point on dress to share about you. And if you get that one point, it'll make you think about what you wear. If you don't get this one point, it's no point in sharing you anything else about dress. And I got one point on entertainment, because I got dress and entertainment to talk to you about. And so I got one point for each, and the rest of the time, I got a bunch of points about Jesus. Is that all right? And so I found out, and I'll tell you why we're going the place that we're going. As a matter of fact, let's open up here at, I got two passages of scripture I want to go to. So let's go to Matthew. I believe it's not chapter 23, but chapter 22. Let's go to Matthew chapter 22, and then we'll go to Exodus 3, and those are the scriptures we're going to turn to today. So let's go to Matthew 22, and then I'll tell you why we're going where we're going and talking about dressing for the party. Matthew 22, if you have your Bibles, praise the Lord. I know it's the afternoon, but there are Bibles in the stall. We still want to study the Bible, amen? We still don't want to just hear a man speak or preach. We want to hear the word of God, and we want to find out how to dress for the biggest party in the history of the world that's about to happen. Matthew, the 22nd chapter, and I want you to swim down to verse 11. Now, what's happening now is he's given a parable, and he's given a parable. Actually, it's about the investigative judgment. And Jesus is giving a parable, and he's telling the people in the temple what the kingdom of heaven is like. And he says, the kingdom of heaven is like a man who made a marriage for his son, and he sent his servants to bid those that were supposed to come go. They started treating his servants bad. They started killing them and doing all manner of evil to them. That's what they did to the servants. So Jesus says, those that were worthy, they're not going to come now. So I want you to go into the highways, and I want you to go into the byways, and I want you to get anybody who will come to the wedding. And they did that. His servants did that. They went and they grabbed everybody that they could find. And we'll swim down to verse 11, and we're going to find out what happens when the king comes to the party. And when the king came in to see the guests, is everybody there? Verse 11. When the king came in there to see the guests, he saw there a man that had not on a wedding garment. He wasn't dressed for the party. And he saith unto him, Friend, how camest thou in hither, not having a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then said the king to his servant, Bind him hand and foot, and take him away, and cast him into outer darkness. There shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth, for many are called, but few are chosen. And what I want to do is show you, if you never have, how to begin the process of putting on this type of clothing that Jesus is talking about. He's talking about none other than the righteousness of Christ. And once we have that robe on, it's going to dictate everything else we do in our life. If we don't understand how to get ready for the marriage feast by wearing Christ's righteousness, then everything else we do will look nice on the outside, but it'll be a lie on the inside. If you understand that, let me hear you say amen. And so we want to find out how to do this. If you already have your wedding garment on, then this message is just for you to maybe take your relationship with God to another level. Maybe you've been struggling with some things. But I primarily want to talk to the youth about how to start the process of putting this garment on. And the reason why I want to focus on Christ is because usually when we have conferences like this and Elder Cooks, if something happens and you get to be a speaker for some Elder Cooks is throwing, he'll usually give you like a Bible verse and a Spirit of Prophecy quote. And the Spirit of Prophecy quote that he gave me so moved me and so shook me, it propelled how we're going to give our message today. And the reason why we're going to focus mostly on Christ, we're going to talk about clothes for a little bit, we're going to focus mostly on Christ, is because this quote right here. There is no use in telling you what you must not wear. There's no use in telling you that you must not wear this or that, for if the love of these vain things is in your heart, is everybody listening? Your laying off of adornments will only be like cutting the foliage off of a tree. The inclinations of the natural heart would again assert themselves. You must have a conscience of your own. My grandma and grandpa were the only person on their side of the family, I think, that accepted the Adventist faith. And then my mom was Adventist and I'm Adventist. So what's that, 2-3 generations? And so I grew up in the church. And one thing I found out is young people who are Seventh-day Adventists are waiting for one thing. 18th birthday. Because when they turn 18, they're going to leave your house and do church how they want to and do everything else how they want to. And we think sometimes if they're just sitting here in the church, then that's enough. But we've got to change their hearts. We've got to get them to want to accept Jesus by themselves. Evangelism 272, paragraph 1, talk of Christ. And when the heart is converted, everything that is out of harmony with the word of God will drop off. And so when people are having a problem with the way they dress, the way they talk, the way they eat, that's an indication to you maybe something's wrong with the heart and you need to pray for them. It does not mean you don't give them the truth about the things that they need to know, but there's a deeper matter in the heart where maybe they are not in love with Jesus. And if they're not in love with Jesus, that's our first work. It's our worst work, everyone? First work. Exodus, the third chapter. Let's go to Exodus and read one of my favorite stories in the Bible. Now I'm getting excited. This is where God comes to talk to a man. Yes, sir. The Lord of heaven and earth comes down to talk to a man, a murdering man, a sinful man. But God comes to talk to him out of anybody else in the whole world. My man Moses. Exodus, the third chapter. And we're going to read verses 1 through 8, 19 and 20, Exodus, the third chapter. And then we're going to stay here and focus here and find out how we begin the process of getting Christ in our heart. It's so crucial for us to know this part because God is here and God is waiting. Let me just pause for a moment. All in the church, we hear about there's a bunch of stuff that we're waiting on God to do. God's already given the Holy Ghost. He's already came down and died. God is waiting for us to do some things so he can do some things. Amen? Amen. Exodus, the third chapter, verse 1 says, Now Moses kept the flock of Jethro, his father-in-law, the priest of Midian. And he led the flock to the backside of the desert and came to the mountain of Horeb, and came to the mountain of God, even to Horeb. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out of the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, and the bush burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. Everybody say, not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside. Everybody say, turn aside. And see this great sight, why the bush is not burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called unto him out of the midst of the bush and said, Moses, Moses. And he said, here am I. And he said, draw not hither, put off thy shoes from off thy feet. The place wherein thou standest is holy ground. God told him how to dress. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon God. Verse 7. And the Lord said, I have surely seen the affliction of my people, which are in Egypt, and I have heard their cry by reason of their taskmasters, for I know their sorrows. I am come down to deliver them out of the hand of the Egyptians, and to bring them up out of that land unto a good land and large, unto a land flowing with milk and honey, and unto the Canaanites and Hittites, and the Amorites and the Perizzites, and the Hivites and the Jebusites. Swim down to verse 19. And I am sure that the king of Egypt will not let you go, no, not by a mighty hand. And I will stretch out my hand and smite Egypt with all my wonders, which I will do in the midst thereof. And after that, he will let you go. Let everybody say amen. Amen. Now, I want you to notice the progression of when God came to talk to this man, Moses. The Bible says that when Moses saw the fire, did Moses create the fire? Did the fire have anything to do with Moses? Did he start it? Did Moses do anything for the bush to be burned with fire? No, but the Bible says when Moses turned aside to look at the fire, then God spoke. When God spoke, he first said his name twice. Moses, Moses. He showed Moses the goodness and mercy of God. We'll get into that in a second. And he showed Moses that he had a desire for a relationship with him. And then he showed Moses, Moses' own character. After God did that, after the flame came and after Moses turned aside and after God called him, after that, God showed Moses how to dress if he wanted to continue their relationship. God didn't announce who he was. God didn't say his name, nor did God say his mission. After God called him and after Moses answered the call, then God said, dress this way. And once Moses complied with that, then he got a revelation of who God was and what God wanted him to do in the earth. If you understand that, let me hear you say amen. Amen. All right, so let's go to this passage and consider the passage. Then we want to find out what's the context of the passage. And then after that, we want to find out what's the content of the passage. Are you ready to study the Bible? All right. The first thing that we need to consider is God's mercy and his desire for a relationship. The Bible says that Moses was leading the flock of Jethro, his father. Why was Moses leading Jethro's flock? Anybody? You can shout it out. This is an 11 o'clock. What was Moses doing in Midian leading sheep? He ran away because what did he do? He killed a man. And so right now, Moses was supposed to be God's deliverer. God had saved his life from dying. Not only did God save his life, God put Moses in the palace. Is everybody with me? When God put Moses in the palace, he was waiting for Moses to get ready. Servant of the Lord says that Moses was not ready for his mission when he killed the Egyptian. Do you know that? He was 40 years old and he wasn't ready. And so God was waiting for Moses to get ready. Moses wanted to do this great thing for the Lord, and then he killed the Egyptian. Hid the Egyptian's body in the sand, was a murderer, fled from the scene, and that's why Moses is now in Midian. And so what God is doing now is he's talking to a man who didn't listen to him the first time. He's talking to a man who actually murdered and killed another human being. And God said, your blood will I require at the hands of another human being. God right now, just by the fact that he's coming and talking to Moses in his place of exile, is showing that he's having mercy on Moses. You see, I have another Bible that I bring that's smaller, but today I brought the Battle Bible. You guys don't know about my Battle Bible. I got this Bible, I don't have to look in the tag, December 19th, 2009. Do you know where I was when I got this Bible? I was locked up in Tracy Prison when I got this Bible. And it's the first Bible I read cover to cover. So you must understand that I gave my heart to the Lord at the tender age of 17, and I left the Lord when I was 20 for reasons that I have of my own. There was no more sacrifice for me. If I would have died any night at the club, I would have went straight to hell. There was no confusion in my life. There was no maybe I believe some other truth or this and that. I chose to leave and reject the Lord. I messed up, just like Moses did. I was in my place of exile. Moses was tending to the sheep. I was trying to scatter the sheep. A selfish, a worldly lifestyle. I lived it for years. But December 19th, I got this in the mail. And that whole time I was in prison, God didn't rush me. God didn't pressure me. God gave me my time, but God led me to this Bible and he let me read it from cover to cover. And when I got out, I still had one half foot in the world, one half foot in the church. And I'm talking to you now about God's mercy and his goodness. There is no reason why God needed to forgive me because I knew the truth, willfully chose to reject the truth, and God saved my life alive all those years, preserved me in prison, let me read his word, let me get out of prison and still play around until 2011 came and he asked me to make a choice and I chose the Lord. Then God proceeded to take me. That was in February, and he had me preaching in May, preaching the whole summer, and I'm preaching here today. Now Moses knew what he was supposed to do, and he chose to disobey the Lord. God has mercy even though you mess up. If you don't understand God's mercy and you don't let it become a realization in your life, you might take off the wrong clothes, but you'll be doing it for the wrong reasons. Because the Bible says it is the goodness of God that leads you to repentance. You have to see how good God is. And when you see how good God's been to you, then you will decide to do whatever God asks you to do. It doesn't matter if it hurts, if it pulls at you. You're going to look at Jesus and say, look what you've done for my life. That's why the Bible says, remember the seventh day Sabbath. Because you are supposed to remember every step of how God leads you, every little facet of your life. You're supposed to find out how good God's been to you. And this prompts your decisions. Amen. God was being good to Moses. He called his name Moses just to let him know your name means drawn for the water. I saved you when all the other kids died. I put you in the palace. You created you. You murdered a man thinking that you were working for me, but I'm still here talking to you. And it was almost as if he didn't get it the first time. Do you remember when the pastor called that lady and she didn't know it was her and they were turning around? What did he have to do? He called her name again. And it's almost like God said, Moses. And then he said, Moses again to let him know, yeah, I'm talking to you. I'm talking to you. I know I'm talking to you. I desire to talk to you who are a murderer. I desire to talk to you who decided to leave me. I desire a relationship and a conversation with you, even though you've done all these wrong things. I have a desire to spend time with you. And if you're here today and you've done incredible things that are against the word of God, God still has a desire to have a relationship with you. Now he wants you to show that same desire. And what is the context of what he was saying? Why did God come to Moses? Is it just because God is good? Is it just because God had mercy on him? We read in verse 19 and 20, God was ready to go to war. God came to Moses because it was wartime. God came to Moses because he said, Moses, I heard the cry of my people. Now I'm ready to fight. God came to Moses and he showed him the flame and fire of the bush because that's what Moses needed to see in order for Moses to go to war. We're going to find out what the fire and the bush is, but we might just jump over it. This week, on Friday, we had a dinner the other night. And we're supposed to be at the dinner at a certain time and place, and my family is a little larger than it was when I was single and I was in the world. And so my wife had to do things before it was time to go to the dinner. She got to the house late, and we didn't get to go to the dinner, and I was mad at the woman. So now we don't have time to go to the dinner. So I didn't say much. I just left the house, and I said, well, I just got enough time then because I wasn't going to get my hair cut, just go to the dinner. I have enough time to get my hair cut for Sabbath. If I get to the barbershop and it's too packed, the one I usually go to, so I have to go to a different barbershop. Remember, I'm talking about war. So this barbershop I go into now, it's at the end of the day, so there's more young guys in this barbershop. So they're drinking already. They got the bottles popping, they're drinking, they're playing their music. It's just the type of atmosphere I would have loved to be in a long time ago. And so the whole time, I'm not saying much, I'm just getting my hair cut. And the guy, he's cutting my hair, and he's actually cutting it pretty fast. And so the whole time, I'm trying to have my composure, and I'm praying to the Lord in my head. And then I get my hair cut, I finish it, and I leave because I'm trying to leave and everything. I'm messing around, rushing to try to beat the Sabbath. It's all right. Some everybody was, maybe two. But as I'm leaving out the door, the head guy, the head young guy who looks like he's the head barber, he was like, man, don't mind us. It's just the weekend. We're trying to have fun, et cetera, et cetera. Man, why don't you come get you a shot? And so all the guys stand up, yeah, come get a shot. Woody, woody, whoop. And they're yelling and screaming and egging me on to get a shot. And right then, everybody in the shop is looking at me. I'm talking about wartime. And so right then, I quiet everybody down, and I begin to tell them how many years I used to drink and what happened when I used to drink and how I've decided now to give my heart to the Lord, and I don't drink that, I drink of the Lord. And I begin to tell them this, and it only took 5 minutes, and when I got to the car, I was pounding on the dashboard, I was mad, I was screaming, why? I wasn't ready for war. That was my pulpit time right there. And I took 5 minutes when maybe I could have had 30 right then. But I'm worried about because I'm late for the dinner. My emotions aren't right because I'm mad at my wife and I wasn't ready for war. And so God was telling me, you're not ready for what I need you to do. You think the only time I need you to speak is when you're in front of a pulpit? Remember, God said, when I hear the cry of the people, then I'm going to come deliver them. Those men in the shop were crying. And God wanted to use me to free them. Now, I did get their card. I know where the shop is at, and I'll be back. But at that time, God was showing me I wasn't ready for war yet. And God was saying, maybe I orchestrated the whole day. Maybe I wanted you to miss the dinner. I had a battle I wanted you to fight. You think I'm wasting your time, 40 years in the wilderness, but I'm getting you ready for war. And he was getting Moses ready for war at that point, but Moses wasn't ready for war yet, just like I wasn't, because you know why? Moses didn't see the master die. You see, there's this movie I used to watch, highly witchcraft, highly spiritualistic. It was called The Phantom Menace. And in this movie, thank you, Jesus. In this movie, these two Jedi Knights, they're fighting the bad Jedi. And as they're fighting the bad Jedi, they're fighting him and they're not really doing good. And then the younger Jedi looks and he gets blocked by this force field and he can't get to his master fighting the enemy. I'm talking about war. His master's fighting the enemy and then the enemy kills his master. And he sees his master get killed, and now the enemy's facing him, he's facing the enemy, and there's a force field, there's a shield that's blocking them. And the part I remember about this movie is where that young soldier was fighting, maybe with half his strength, he's waiting for the force field to get away so he can get to the enemy, and he's not waiting like this, he's hopping up and down like this. He's ready to fight the enemy. Why? Because he just saw his master die. I'm telling you, you can read the Bible and you can pray, but until you get your mind wrapped around the cross of Jesus, until you see the master die, until you find out what he's done for you, until you make that your all and all, because that's the place where God shows his goodness and his mercy. You gotta watch the master die every day. When you watch the master die, nobody has to tell you to pass out a track at the gas station. You're ready to fight the enemy. Nobody has to tell you it's time to give your testimony. You're ready to fight the enemy. And what I'm trying to communicate to you right now is God had to bring Moses to a place on this mountain where he focused Moses' attention on the death of the master. Now watch this. When you go to war, you can't wear flip-flops and tank tops in war. Going to war means you have a war uniform on. Is everybody with me? When you go to war, you have to have your war clothes on. And so I want to bring you one point about clothes, one point about entertainment, and then we'll go back to talking about Jesus. Is that all right? All right. Now the scriptures say your clothes point to what group you're in. Proverbs 7:10, and behold, there met him a woman with the attire of a harlot and a subtle heart. It didn't say the woman was a harlot. It said she had the attire of one on. All right, now listen to the Bible. Genesis 38:15-16. When Judah saw her, he thought her to be a harlot. Why? Because she had covered her face. Now in this time, covering your face meant you were a harlot. In these times, uncovered. And so the Bible is saying that by how you dress, people might judge who you are. Who's this? How do you know? How do you know he ain't faking? He's dressed like a fireman. Who's this? A chef. How do you know? He's dressed like a chef. Now, are you going to go to the chef and tell him your house is on fire? Why? Because the fact that he's dressed like a chef, you think he has the skills of a chef. And so if you need chef skills, you're going to go to the person who's dressed like the chef. If your house is on fire and you need to be saved, you're going to go to the person who's dressed like they can save your house on fire. You're not going to go to the chef and tell him you have diabetes and you need some kind of surgery. Because automatically, you're going to figure that's not his skill set. Not only are you going to know that that's not his skill set, because he's a chef and because he's a fireman, you can even look up online and almost find out how much money this person makes. You can determine who they are, what they do, their skill set, and even their financial standing just by what these men are wearing. Now, what's that look like? A police officer. You be quiet for a second. Now, this looks like a police officer. Are you going to go to him and ask him to teach you Kenpo, martial arts? Look at y'all some old sinners. Y'all been watching Hard Target, Under Siege, in the 90s, yeah, okay. Are you gonna ask him now? All right, you gonna ask him now, why? He looks like he's somebody who could teach you martial arts. He's the same person. So whether he had these clothes on, he was a martial artist, but by the way he was dressed, you don't know he's a martial artist. One point I gotta make about dress. That even natural law tells us how you dress associates you with certain groups of people. If you understand that, let me hear you say amen. If you claim to be a Christian, you ought to dress like a Christian. The way you dress, people will look at you and put you in certain groups. We automatically do it. It's the way we make sense of the world. Psychology calls it schemas. There's these brain maps that we have that we put things in a category so we can better understand the world. We already judge so that we can understand things, put them into categories. How you dress will associate you with certain groups. So if you're wondering what's wrong with this and what's wrong with that, why your parents might not want you to wear certain things, it's because it makes you look like a certain person. If you're wondering why the spirit of prophecy and the church, they're talking about why you should not wear certain things, it's because it associates you with a certain type of group. If you understand that, let me hear you say amen. That's my one point on dress. If you reject this point, I really don't have anything else to say. Because how you dress associates you with certain groups of people. If you don't want to be associated with a certain group of people, you shouldn't look like that. Not only that, if I'm looking for a police officer, where am I going to go? To the police station. So how you dress is going to make me determine where I can find you. When I used to go to the club, we look for the type of girls who are dressed like what we're there for. And we weren't there to just be friendly and nice. And so some of them would carry themselves a certain kind of way. Other ones would carry themselves a different kind of way. And by the way they would carry themselves dictated how we would treat these women. I used to have a trick I used to do. All you girls, listen up. Lyric, Julie, listen up. This is the trick I used to do. I used to go in the club. And I used to, you know, look for the girls. And then I used to go up to the girl I was trying to talk to and grab her. If she lets me touch her, then I already got her. If she doesn't have enough respect for herself, first, they're always apprehensive. They pull away the arm. But then you know what happens? I say a couple words, they start laughing. And so I would go and already break down the barrier by physically touching the girl, grabbing her, because if she's got respect for herself, she's going to tell me, get your hands off me. I don't even know who you are. But by the way she's dressed, she looks like she wanted me to touch her. This is my worldly mind state. I'm telling you how the guys think in the world. And so that's what I would go do. And the same is vice versa for the women. I was working somewhere and I got coworkers, and your coworkers are being cool with you and stuff like that. And sometimes they try to play with you. And I tell the girls, don't touch me. I'm married. This is spoken for. Look, but don't touch. And they laugh and joke. But every time they try to play, I go, don't touch me. Keep your hands off me. You can't be just touching me. I'm spoken for. You understand? This is the cream of the crop, diamond in the rough, but it's not sure. Don't touch me. Keep your hands off of me. Somebody else puts their hands on me. It's not you. Now I got to hurry up. You guys making me take too long. All right. Facts about entertainment. You can look on any website, any news site, and you'll find out the more you watch something, the more it desensitizes you from that thing. Amen? That's a basic fact. No matter if you think it's good or if you think it's bad, I'm not even going to debate that with you. The more you watch it, the more used to it you get. Is everybody with me? All right. This transforms your character. The Bible says, but we all with open face beholding as in a glass the glory of the Lord are changed into the same image from glory to glory even by the Spirit of the Lord. And so as you behold, you become changed. Watch this. This is how it goes. Your character is made up of your thoughts and what, everyone? Emotions or feelings, whichever verbiage you like to use. This determines your character. And so if there's something that you think bad about, you have a bad thought about it, and it gives you a feeling of disgust, you are going to be more prone to reject that thing. Is everybody with me? Your character is you're going to move aside from that thing, not go near that thing, you'll reject it. But if something, if it's just, so-so, you kind of don't care about it that much. It's not necessarily bad. It's not necessarily good. You got a neutral, uncaring attitude. This is going to give you an enchanted emotion about it. What's that? An emotion of delight. Although I found that interesting, that delight means enchant. And then what kind of character are you going to have about this thing? You're going to be tolerant of it. And so the more you watch something that's bad, even if you try to tell yourself you think it's bad, what's really happening is that you're neutral to it or you're going to start to like it. This is going to enchant you, give you a feeling, because if you keep watching it, there's something in it that's drawing you. It delights you. And then you're going to tolerate that thing. Maybe in public, maybe not in public, maybe in private, but you still will tolerate. If you understand that, let me hear you say amen. And so when something desensitizes you, the more you watch it, the more it's changing your character about that certain thing. If you understand that, let me hear you say amen. Desire of Ages 3:24, paragraph 1. We may leave off many bad habits for a time. We may part company with Satan, but without a vital connection with God, through the surrender of ourselves to him, how often? Moment by moment, we shall be overcome. Without a personal acquaintance with Christ and continual communion, we are at the mercy of the enemy and shall do his bidding in the end. I had one sin I hung on to when I turned 17 that I never gave up, and that was women. And what it did is it put a barrier between my vital connection with God and my continual communion. And so I had broken communion because I had communion with God until when? Until it was time to indulge my favorite sin. When that happened, the communion wasn't continual. Why? Because Isaiah 59 says sin separates you from God. And so when the communion was broken, in the end, I went out in the world and did what? The enemy's bidding. You got to have a vital connection day by day. And what it looks like is what happened in Moses' life. God called Moses his name because he wanted to express to Moses his mercy, his desire for a relationship. But he called Moses because he said, Moses, it's time to go to war. The Bible says in Revelation 12, 17, that you are in a war whether you want to be or not. The devil has come down to you. He's having great wrath. There was a war in heaven. That war got transferred to this earth. We heard about that war this morning, did we not? And this battle is fighting. This battle is raging. And when God calls you into the Seventh-day Adventist Church, it's not just because he wants to put his mercy on you, not just because you are to see his goodness. He's looking for soldiers in the last days. And he wants to know if you want to fight on his side or on the enemy's side. And when he was calling Moses, he said, Moses, it's time to go to war. What's up? Now, if you don't have your Bibles, turn to Exodus 3. Let's read verse 2 and verse 3. I'm going to read in your hearing. And the angel of the Lord appeared unto him in a flame of fire out the midst of the bush. And he looked, and behold, and the bush was burned with fire, and the bush was not consumed. And Moses said, I will now turn aside and see this great sight, why the bush is burnt. And when the Lord saw that he turned aside to see, God called. And so watch this now. Moses decided to turn aside. When God saw that he turned aside, then God spoke. Do you want God to speak to you? Then you got to turn aside. And that word turn aside, that word, that verb that's used, it's a causal verb, which means God didn't turn him aside. It means the person that turned aside is the person that caused it. God had the bush. God had the fire. God did not speak. It was Moses' decision if he would go to the bush. And so you have to decide for yourself if you're going to turn aside. Not only is that word turn aside a causal verb, it's a single action. It denotes a process moving towards completion. The Spirit of Prophecy quote we read said that you have to have continual communion, a vital connection with God. And so what God is calling you to right now in this session is if you want to decide to keep your connection continual, do you want to begin the process? And if you've begun the process, do you want to move to higher ground of turning aside and seeing what God has for you? And what God has for you is so simple, I'm so scared none of you will actually go do it once we actually get to it. Because it seems too simple. It seems like that might not work. That word turning aside means to deviate. It actually carries a connotation that it means to reject the current path you're on and choose to go another path. And so when Moses saw the bush and he saw it on fire, but he saw that the fire did not consume the bush, Moses decided to reject the sheep path he was on. Are you with me? To reject the job he had at that moment. To reject the relationship he had at that moment. To reject exactly what he was doing at that moment. And look at what God was doing. He decided to turn aside. God didn't cause him to turn aside. He's got to cause it himself. And I guess what I'm really trying to communicate to you is when are you going to decide to stop doing whatever you're doing in life and turn aside and ask God what he wants you to do? We think everything that we do, God must want us to do these things without. Do you know there's some days God doesn't even want you to eat any food? There's some days where God does not want you. You got to eat. But there's some days where God, I don't want you to eat today. There's something else I need you to do. There's something coming up. I know there's some days God doesn't want you to do things that's even okay for you to do. But if you don't turn aside and see what God is doing, you'll decide to do whatever you've been doing. Because it was God who blessed Moses with a place to stay at Jethro's place. It was God who chose to put Moses as a shepherd to fit him for his job. But right then, Moses had to decide to turn aside and see what the master wanted. And so many Christians never stop what they're doing every day to turn aside and ask God what he's doing. All right. This word, turn aside, actually means that you don't just deviate from the path, but you draw near to something else. And what God wanted Moses to do is stop what he was doing, deviate from his path, reject his path, turn aside, and draw near to the fire in the bush. I was spending some time with God, and I was asking him what this fire in the bush meant. And the fire is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. Did you know that? The fire is also a symbol, according to Revelation, the 14th chapter, of the wrath of God. Because men are going to be tormented with fire and brimstone when they experience God's wrath. So the fire is a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And I ask now, what does it mean? The Bible says that Jesus grew up before them as a tender plant. Not only does it call Jesus a tender plant, Jesus calls himself the true vine. Not only is it that, but in Jeremiah, Jesus is called the branch. So over and over in the Bible, Jesus is compared to and he's likened to a plant. And so I said, all right, Holy Ghost, Jesus is a plant and Jesus is on fire. But what does that mean? Jesus had the Holy Ghost? Is that what you're telling me to communicate? And the Bible went on further. We went to Hebrews 9 and 14. And watch this now. This is what a true Christian on fire looks like. How much more then shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit did what, everyone? Offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead, what, everyone? Works to serve the living God. What does it mean that through the Spirit he offered himself? Hebrews 9:28, in that same chapter, if you keep going down, the Bible explains itself. Don't let anybody ever tell you it don't. Sometimes you got to just keep reading. Go to another scripture, but you'll find out what it means. He offered himself through the eternal Spirit. The Bible says, so Christ once offered to bear what, everyone? Sin. The sins of many. When did Christ offer himself to bear the sins of many? On Calvary's cross. And so what Moses was seeing, remember, I will not suffer thy Holy One to see corruption. Moses was looking at the bush on fire, but the bush was not consumed. He was looking at the bush on fire, but that bush was still standing there on fire. Jesus, even though he's got his eternity back and his immortality back, do you know his body is still on fire? He's still got the nail prints in his hand. He's still got the scars on his back and in his head. He still has the same body who the Bible says the Spirit led him to offer his body. When Jesus was on the cross, that's Christianity on fire. The Holy Spirit was with Jesus when he was on the cross, just like the Holy Spirit was with John when he was getting his head cut off. We think an on-fire Christian just looks like somebody in activity for God, but it looks like somebody willing to lay down their life for Jesus. And Jesus was on fire. Moses was looking at a picture of Jesus on the cross. And when God wanted to show him this, because remember, once you see the master die, you're ready to fight the enemy. Until you see the master die, you really don't know why you're fighting the enemy. You're really not ready, but you have to see the master go to battle first. Do you know why Alexander the Great was so successful in his wars? Because he was always on the front line of battle. And when his men saw the king fighting like that, it inspired something in them that no other army could defeat. And the problem with the people in our church, the problem with the youth, is that they're not seeing Jesus on fire. They're not seeing the bush burn, but it not be consumed, because even though Jesus died, we found out through the music today that he was resurrected the third day. That he did not have to pay the ultimate penalty of being wiped out for sin. Why? Because it was not possible that death should hold him. He lived a sinless life, a perfect life, and death couldn't hold him. He paid the penalty, but he was not consumed by that bush. That word bush actually means a thorny bush. That bush on fire was Jesus with the crown on his head. My favorite picture of Jesus is not even the picture when he's on the cross with the crown on his head. You know what my favorite picture of Jesus is when I meditate on the cross? It's the time the Roman soldiers had him in the purple garment and they put the crown on his head and the reeve in his hand and they began to mock him. Because he's standing there and he's about to die for the sins of the world. He's been beaten on his back twice. Blood is pouring down his back. He hasn't eaten all night. They shove a crown of thorns on his head, take his clothes off him roughly. And if you ever had a scar, you can't even move that part of your body. And so he has to take off his clothes and they put another garment on it. They put a reed in his right hand. Thank you, Jesus. And they stand him there in the praetorium. And the Bible says a whole band of soldiers. So that's not one or two. That's almost 200 to 600. Soldiers, they all bow the knee mocking Jesus. But in the morning when I see that sight, I bow the knee and I say, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, that you let them spit on you. You let them make fun of you. You let them do all this manner of evil to you. Because when I was sinking down in sin, you said Tim is going to need some help in 2009. And so I got to go right now. You got to look at the master die. If you're going to be ready to fight. And when he dies and you accept this great sacrifice on bended knee and say, Lord, I accept and I trust in your resurrection. Then when you decide to turn aside and see this, Jesus tells you how to dress. He takes a robe and he puts it on your back that you don't deserve. He promises you a crown that you didn't earn. He promises you a throne that you have no royal claims to, but he does it because he is on fire. But he's not consumed. He has life in his hands, and he desires to give this life to you. You must understand, when you look at Jesus on the cross, you are looking, listen to me now, at the most powerful thing that exists in the universe. Jesus dying and rising from the grave, before he sent him out, he said, I have all power, which means all the power that has ever existed and that will ever exist, I've got all of it. I'm the most powerful thing in existence, and I'm giving this power to you. Now that you have a realization of how much power I have, because you beheld me on the cross, now you can go out. Now you can make the decision, which group do you want to be a part of? Because what you decide to wear associates you with certain groups. And if you look at the death of the master, you're always going to want to be in his group. From now until eternity. And so my prayer is that every day, how often did I say?
Every
day, you would turn to one of the gospels. You would turn to the portion of the Gospels where Jesus is dying on the cross. You would read it, sit there, and think about it. That's it. This whole sermon was just made for me to say that one particular point. You would sit there and think about what Jesus did for you. It sounds shallow. It sounds ritualistic. It sounds maybe like you shouldn't do it, but you have no idea the power in it until you do. You have no idea what it does to your mind and heart. Just last night, I have a problem with eating too late. I know I'm the only one. And God said, we got to start weaning you off. So we'll give you a time to eat, and then we're going to give you, I'll eat a whole plate of food, like at 12 o'clock. Like it's 5 o'clock. Say, no, no, no. Tonight, you just eat some crackers. We're weaning you off. Weaning you off. So last night, I just had some crackers. I'm glad I listened to the Holy Spirit, because the message I just heard, I would have felt real bad standing up here preaching if I didn't just have my crackers. But that was just last night. Next week, Friday, I need to have a different testimony. Why? Because if I continually see the death of the master, it's going to get me ready to fight. I'm not going to stay in the same place. I'm not going to stay eating the same thing. I'm going to keep growing and growing. And looking at Jesus on the cross makes you say, wow. He wouldn't even drink something because it messed up his mind. while he was being tortured to death, and I'm sitting up here in my sealed walled palace and I'm struggling with eating this thing right now. And then I begin to call on that power that's on the cross, and it helps me do what he said. And so what I'm encouraging you to do, what I'm encouraging you to even do with your kids, is to get them to behold the bush on fire. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, I thank you. I'm so sorry I went 20 minutes over. But I ask now that you send your power, your Holy Spirit, to invigorate us, Lord, for the last message we'll hear. That you would send your Holy Spirit to the Wackford Center before we get there, so that we don't leave the Holy Ghost behind, so that we can still fellowship with you as we fellowship with one another. We love you, Lord, and we praise you. In Jesus' name, amen.